In this video, I want to talk about how you can get started using n8n in order to start building the ideas and apps and softwares that you've always dreamed about. Because here's the cool thing about n8n. You don't need to know how to code. You don't need to know how to program. I have no idea how to do that. I've been building bots for the past 6 months. I build bots for clients that they're using in production in their businesses in order to be able to automate entire positions away or to be able to make themselves more efficient up to like 8 times. I've seen people have tasks that used to take them like 8 hours and now they can get it done in either half an hour or an hour just by pushing a button and letting the system run. So technically they're not even doing anything. They're spending like a few seconds to push a button. But I want to talk about kind of what is the process? What is the flow that you're going to have to go through in order to get started? Well, for starters, you have to have an n8n account. So number one, have an account. So just go to n8n.io and here's the pricing. All right. They do have I think it's a 14-day free trial. And so when you sign up, you'll want to set, you probably can start off with the starter. I started with the starter and I do it monthly. I never do annual. I just don't want to pay everybody for a year of software that I'm not sure is going to work out for me. So I always start off monthly. But, 5 active workflows is probably a good one. By and large, you don't need your workflows to be active unless you intend for them to run autonomously. All right. So if you have a workflow, do I have an example of a workflow that I would like actually be willing to show you on camera at the moment? Not at the moment. Oh, like, okay. My database uploader here. So this one, I guess I could set it to active, but I so infrequently need to use this. I would just upload something to a Google Drive folder and I would click test workflow. I don't need an active workflow to be able to do that. I just come over, upload it, click the button. It's good to go. It's now in my database. My bots are all able to use it. All right. And so you come over to n8n, you sign up for their plan. You just click the button. Okay, I had to actually open an incognito window to be able to show you this because when I clicked free trial, it opened my account. So what you do, click free trial, it's gonna open up a page. And all you do is you put in your name, your email, your password, you give it account name, and that's about it. Actually, that's it. And then you're gonna have an n8n account. All right, so next, you need to have an idea. When I say an idea, I mean, what is it you want to automate? What is it you want to build? What is it you want to do? Now, you're not going to be building like a full video game in an n8n, but you're able to build automations that are able to really save yourself some time. So some examples that I've built for clients, I had one that took all of their Shopify product listings. It had a picture of their product with it and a brief description that they had written, but the descriptions were bad. And so what we did was we had the model look at their title and their description and look at the picture. And then it was able to identify the Google taxonomy number that went with it. So it would match up with Google Merchant Center. It was able to identify whether they were for adults or children. It was able to label the colors all for Google Merchant Center. And then also was able to write an SEO optimized title, an SEO optimized description for those products. That way their products would appear higher in Google when being searched for, so that made their ads more effective, made their organic search more effective, and just overall was able to raise their ability to sell their products. That's just one example. And so you have to have an idea of what you want. And when it comes to ideas, there's this thing called ChatGPT. I hope you've heard of it. So you're just gonna say, hey, I need some ideas for an n8n workflow for my, what kind of business do you have? Maybe a life coaching business. That's it. That's all you need to do. It's going to come up with some ideas. And it's got my wife's name for some reason. It stored her name in long-term memory. And no matter how many times I make copy, it refuses. And it's even got my picture up here. So I don't know why it says Diana. Anyway, so a smart follow-up agent. So if you have a form submission, it will, it can enrich the lead. That's an awesome idea to enrich the lead. Maybe grab their information from like Apollo or from LinkedIn, you add it to a CRM, send them a custom welcome email with a scheduling link, set reminders. So you can either send email or an SMS after an X number of days. It's also a good idea. And add to audience for automated value drip emails. So when they sign up for your form, yeah, you can use GetResponse or, what's Bluehost? What are the other email platforms? It's been so long since I've used other email platforms. But why pay for all those extra services when you can just build it yourself? So easy. It is actually really easy. You just set up a Google Sheet and then you just mark off. You can include the copy in it, the date that it should be sent out, and it just, and then have it run every day. It's so much easier than having to pay for all these extra services. Session summarizer and next steps generator. That's actually a great idea. I might build that one myself. So you upload meeting transcripts. It's actually something I have on my list to build. Use Whisper to transcribe it. GPT summarizes key points and generates a coaching recap for the client, action items, and a journal prompt for them, right? Because it's lifestyle coaching. And then you email or text the summary plus reminders. Weekly motivation and check-in bot. So just every week, so you have a schedule node, schedule trigger node, and then you every Monday morning at 8 a.m., give them some weekly motivation. So for each client, generate a personalized motivational message. Oh, that's even, it's even better. It's not just a general message. You can set it per client with the things and issues that they've got going on in their lives. And so I just wanted to show you real quick. All you got to do is use ChatGPT. It'll come up with a ton of different ideas. And if you don't like the ideas, ask it to generate some more. All right. So that's number two. You need to have an idea of what you're doing. Third thing you need to do is you need to be able to connect the credentials. So going back to ChatGPT for a second, it kind of gives you an idea of what you might need to connect. So here we need Google Sheets, maybe Airtable. You might need an email or an SMS. So SMS would be like Twilio. Email might be like Gmail. All right. So you need to have the credentials set up. And to do that, you just either do that, open one of these, an overview real quick, if it'll load. Okay. And then you click credentials. You can set up your credentials in here just by coming up to the top here, this drop down, create credential. You have the option of creating a new credential, and they've got so many different kinds of pre-programmed credentials already, and they're adding new ones all the time. So let's say, open this up. So Google Sheets. So we need a Google Sheets trigger or an auth. Say trigger, hit continue, and it just has me sign in with Google. So you would just sign in with your Google account, and that's all it takes for Google Sheets. All right, what else did we see in there? Maybe OpenAI. I'll show you OpenAI. Close that. So create credentials, open that, OpenAI. Just do that. And then you would need to set up your OpenAI API. And so I do have a video on how to do that. I'll put the link in the description below as well for that one. But just, you need to know which credential you need to set up. And the other option is to actually just set up the node. So if it's one of the nodes in here, so let's say Drive, just as an example, Google Drive, we'll just update a file. It doesn't really matter. When you're first setting this up, you won't have anything in the credential to connect with, but you just click on create new credential and there's that window. All you gotta do is fill it in. So you would set up the Google Cloud Console credentials. I'll put a link for that in the description below as well on how to set that up. And if you join my free school community, I've got a ton of different how to set up these credentials videos. It's all available for free as well. It's also on my YouTube channel. You don't have to join the school community if you really, really don't want to. Okay, so you just set up the credentials. To be able to use these processes, you need to set these up correctly. Each node has their own kind of little special thing. So for HTTP request nodes, sometimes you don't even need credentials. So maybe if I wanted to pull information off of a website, I would just put the URL in here. I don't need any credentials for that. I would just have a get the website URL, none, hit test step, and then it would pull the information from the website for me. So each node is a little bit different. There's also different kinds of credentials. So the reason I have the HTTP node here is because here, if I click authentication, I can do either a predefined credential or a generic credential. Generic credentials have these options of basic, header, OAuth 2, and predefined are kind of the same ones we just saw when we were setting up our credentials list. So these are all the predefined ones that come standard with n8n. If you're going to do a generic credential, so your options are basic, bearer, custom auth, and that depends on the service that you're using. Sometimes you don't even set up the credential using any of these authorizations. You would set it to none, and you might have to attach it to the URL. So when you're building this out, you will have to check out the documentation for whatever platform, whatever service you're looking to connect with in order to be able to do it right. And sometimes ChatGPT will be able to do it well. So if I say, how do I set up an OpenAI API key? It should give me that one. Other services, it's a little bit spotty. It might have bad data. Just remember that the data that they have is not always up to date. And so if you run into that situation, I'll just stop this. Instead of just having it asking the question, you say, search the internet for the OpenAI documentation for how to set up the API. And then what it'll do is it'll search the web, it'll go to the documentation, it'll pull it for you, and then it processes it. That's a much smarter way of doing it, all right? So I see people just going, hey, ChatGPT, how do I? It's not necessarily always gonna do it right for you. But if you have it go and search the documentation first, you're almost always gonna get it right in that situation. All right, and so this is how you do it with pip install if you want, but here's how you integrate it with n8n. It tells you exactly how. So that would be how to do the credentials. Oops, let's come over here. All right, and then the last thing you need is you need data, because workflows, automations don't work unless there's something for them to act on. So you'll see here I have a click trigger node. A click trigger node is literally just I click this button and it starts. But I don't have to use just a click trigger node. I can do my sheets, Google Sheets, come down to triggers on something like row added. We'll do that. And so I would set up my Google Sheets trigger, credentials here. I would have a sheet that I want to pull from. I'll just grab one. And then the tab in that sheet I want to pull from. And then when I click fetch test event, it should work. Oh, for some reason, okay, hold on. I need to refresh the page. Let's refresh the page, get rid of that click trigger. Oh, it pulled it as soon as I hit stop. It was just a visual issue. And so you'll see it pulled all the information from that. And then it divides it up based on the columns, based on the rows. Each row is its own item, and each column is one of these guys here. And these guys in the schema here is information that you're able to use in further processes. So let me just grab another sheets, and then we'll update row and sheets. And I'm just gonna grab the same exact one I just did to be able to show kind of how to use these things. So it'll pull the sheets, all the columns for me. And if I wanted to update a row in a sheet, or basically in any other type of node where I want the data to be processed from the past, you come over to schema and you can just grab the information. You just grab it and pull it over to where you want it to be put into. So if I wanted to update my company tagline or motto, cell for that particular row that I'm updating, I could just grab it over and stick it in there, and now it says yes. And then this here is JavaScript. It took me a little while to learn that it was actually JavaScript. I just like, oh, it's just green. If it doesn't work, then it's red. But if it's green, it means it's processing data. Quick caveat, not always. Just because it's green does not mean it's actually going to work. Sometimes if you have certain kinds of nodes or certain kinds of processes that you're running, it may say that it's green while you're like testing it, but then in actual production, it breaks because some process kind of messed up the path to get there for it. And so you'll sometimes get errors. I do have some other videos on my YouTube channel explaining expression pathing, explaining merge nodes and how those all work. So maybe take a look at those if you're having some issues. Just understand that if it's green, most likely it is properly passing the information from past nodes into your current node for processing. And so, things that you can do, maybe you have an AI generate like copy for, either ad copy or website copy or report that you're writing, homework that you're doing. It doesn't really matter to me, right? And you want to put it into a Google Doc. Well, you would just grab it from that sheet or from the prior node. You stick it in there, bam. If you need to format it, do be aware that certain platforms use different kinds of formatting. So Google Docs just does not accept basically any kind of formatting. So it's just not going to format your documents correctly. Whereas other platforms, say you're uploading to a website, updating maybe a WordPress blog, if you're sending it as HTML, you would be using HTML code. Sometimes Markdown is more effective. Markdown is like the hashtag symbols, backslash ends, whereas HTML is H1s, H2 codes for headers, the braces, the angled braces with the P's for paragraphs, that sort of thing. So just be aware of the language that you're using and how the data is processing. But that's it. That's kind of the beginning stuff that you need to know for n8n. And my recommendation is just kind of start with that idea. Use ChatGPT. It'll kind of tell you what nodes. If it says, oh, would you like me to develop you a, let's see. Would you like me to build one of these for you? It's an okay start, but it's going to be using bad code or old code at the very least. Half the nodes aren't even going to work right. Close that. I don't even need that anymore. Half of them aren't even going to work right. What I do is I'll just sit there and I spend, you know, about an hour to build an entire workflow for a customer. And that's not counting the actual, like, making sure it works right. It's just the structure. I start with the idea of the structure. How do I want this data to flow? Well, if I'm getting a Google information from a Google sheet, that information, how do I need it to process? Well, do I need to sort that data first? Probably, because, you know, if I have a big sheet that I've run through numerous times, I first need to have maybe an if node. An if node will allow me to break out values that have already been processed. So I can set something to, if something is equal to done, then they'll come up the top path. If that's not set to equal to done, it'll go down the bottom path. And so you can break your information and just kind of visualize it as a tree, a big old tree chart that ends up where you want it to be. And then maybe the data needs to be passed through an AI node, and then the AI will process it somehow and produce an output. And that output can either be, you know, just text, or the output might be a structured JSON. And I have a video on structured JSONs in the link below as well that explains how to get data out of AI nodes in the way that you want it to be. And so you just kind of have it flow, the data flow. I like to think of it as a pipe, or sometimes I think of it as like brushing my daughter's hair. So, you know, if you're brushing a hair, if you've ever had a child or if you have long hair yourself, you don't start necessarily at the top. And I think of the top as the end of the workflow. You're supposed to start at the bottom of the hair in order to get the knots out at the bottom in order to be able to work your way up. And it's the same with the workflows. You start here at the start, make sure the data is flowing right in order to be able to get to the bottom of the workflow so that it flows like a nice pipe and the water's going through it. And I use these metaphors because that's how I think of it. But that's it. That's kind of what you need in order to get started with n8n. Like, it's the four basics. You need an n8n account. You need to have some idea of what you're building. You need to have the credentials necessary in order to build that thing. And then you have to have the data be able to actually flow properly through the workflow in order to be able to be generated and output the way that you want it. So if this was helpful, please subscribe to the channel, like and share the video, because it really does help get this information out there to those who need it. Also, if you click the link in the description below, you can join my free school community where I have a ton more tutorials, a ton of free n8n workflows that can get you started. You know, my community is always building off of my workflows. I like to think that I'm giving them a good base, not that I'm not building great workflows. But they're always finding ways to improve the workflows, and I'm more than happy to take your suggestions. Maybe it might even become a new workflow that I'm able to share with the community as well. And you know, as always, I'm Bradford Carlton. Let's automate your success together.